First, I want to say thank you to all of you that have come out on today, gentlemen and women of the press, all the representatives from our community organizations throughout our city, and our very own mayor. This is a very important issue in which we've come together around on today, and that's the repealing of the Affordable Care Act. Current health care bill, repeal bill that Congress will take away from health care workers for more than, we have more than 30 million Americans that will be affected by the repeal of the Affordable Care Act. Congress needs to show us that there's a plan in place to keep Americans covered before they vote to take away the health care coverage that we count on. We need care, not chaos. If the Affordable Care Act is repealed without a replacement, over 75,000 current residents of the city of Syracuse will be at risk of losing their health care coverage. That's just in our city alone. Counties and representative of John Cackle's district will potentially lose up to $12 million in state funding. That means less money for policing, for schools, for other essential community services. Or we can just raise taxes and that will cover the shortfall. Hospitals in Representative Cathcart district could lose up to $83 million a year in federal funding. We know just by hearing some of these numbers and just thinking about the impact that could happen in this city, what could happen nationally in regard to the repeal without a replacement for the Affordable Care Act. Without further ado, I would like to introduce one of our own champions for rights for this residents of the city of Syracuse that's constantly been an advocate for working people, families, keeping our community safe, and my favorite mayor, our very own Stephanie Miner. Let's put our hands together for her.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I am pleased to be here to start what is going to be a march for justice. Yeah. Make no mistake about it. The Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, it covers children, it covers young adults, it covers seniors, it covers entrepreneurs. It makes sure that Americans have access to affordable health care so we do not have a system where people are victimized by insurance companies, where they are forced to use emergency rooms for primary care, where children are forced to go to school without vaccines, without health care. We have turned that corner as Americans, and we are not going to go back. Now, you're going to hear today from people who will talk to you on a very personal basis about what the Affordable Care Act means to them and what it means to their families. I'm here to tell you that every single day I see people who take advantage of the Affordable Care Act to make sure that they and their families get what they need. From parents who talk to me about their children who are graduating from college and need the extra time on their insurance and how that has made parents feel safe and feel better about their children's future, making sure that they have health care. About families and teachers in the school district who talk about the fact that Obamacare has allowed them to make sure that those children get vaccines and health care and the coverage that they need to make sure that they can focus on learning, not focus on their sickness. About doctors and administrators in the city of Syracuse who talk about the fact that with Obamacare and the Affordable Care Act, emergency rooms are no longer used to treat colds and coughs. They are instead used to treat true emergencies. Now, we know that when people have access to health care, when they can focus on health care, when they get health care, then they can focus on getting the jobs that they want, moving forward with their families, and taking care of themselves. What we also know is that we will not allow our government, and make no mistake about it, it is our government. We will not allow them to jump off a cliff and say that they're going to repeal health care and say in 2 years we'll tell you what the replacement's going to be. Oh, no.
Oh, no.
Oh, no.
No.
That you are going to see this group here and many more millions of Americans holding their government, their Congress, their president accountable for the health care that they have paid for, that they've been promised, that they've signed up for, that they need, that makes our society function. Today is the first day on what is the last day of the Obama administration. And we have learned from President Obama and Michelle Obama, we have learned that we need to fight for what we care about, we need to stand up and represent our values, and we have learned that the best thing that we can do to do honor to his administration and what he has done for this country is to stand up and make sure that our government continues to provide us the health care that we need. So this is not the last. This is not the last of us gathering together in front of microphones. It's not the last of us marching, and it is certainly not the last of us telling our elected officials that we are going to be heard with our voices and we're going to be heard with our votes. So put yourself on notice. We're here, and we're going to make you accountable for the decisions you make that impact us and our community. Now, I am pleased to turn over the microphone to Tatiana Parker. Is Tatiana someplace? Come on up. Come on up. Go on up, Tatiana.
Hello, and good afternoon, everyone. My name is Tatiana Parker, and I am a community advocate for health care. I like to think that I have a unique perspective when it comes to the Affordable Care Act because of the many different hats that I wear. As a parent, the Affordable Care Act has allowed me to cover my children under Child Health Plus. I am working, but due to the prices of an individual plus one plan, if I were to have my children insured under my job policy, I would be working strictly for insurance coverage. I would not have any money left over for anything else. In addition to my personal experience, I have academic experience. I am going to school for my master's in public policy, focusing on healthcare. So I understand that the ACA is just not only about health coverage, but consumer protection as well. We can't forget that. We can't forget the ban on lifetime limits. The pre-existing conditions. Just so many things that were put in place to protect consumers, to ensure that providers are providing quality care, just not providing care to many people. One of the most moving things I will say about the Affordable Care Act comes from my professional experience. I've worked for a number of insurers, both private and public. And there was one day at work, I was speaking to a woman on the phone whose husband lost his job. She found out a couple of months later, earlier, that she was pregnant. She called us trying to get a policy, and I had to tell her that because she had seen the doctor for her pregnancy within the last 6 months, that her pregnancy was now a pre-existing condition and would not be covered over the next 18 months. So let's try to put our political ideals aside and really get down to the basis that these are real people that we're dealing with here with this Affordable Care Act. These are people's lives now, these are future lives, and we have to do everything that we can possibly do to make sure they have the best possible outcomes. Thank you.
And now we're at Charles Jackson.
You may have to hold it, Charles.
Hold it.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Charles Jackson, and I work for a drug prevention organization. But I'm here speaking in general. Before I came here to Syracuse, I worked for Congresswoman Yvette Clark in the 9th Congressional District down in Brooklyn. And one of my specialties was the Department of Health and Human Services. So I have some knowledge of the ACA. And I'm not here to talk about any one particular law advocating for the ACA or against the ACA, but what I would stress is a couple of ideas. Most folks who are covered now under the expansion of Medicaid and Medicare, and also through the Affordable Care Act, many of them would not be covered for mental health and substance abuse. About 30% of those who are covered now are getting that assistance. Through the expansion of Medicaid, Medicare, the vast majority of folks have been women and children. Now men are being put into it. And with that, most of them have a substance or a mental health issue. The other thing is pre-existing. If you've been through, if you've gone to rehab and you switch insurances, that's a pre-existing condition. So you wouldn't get covered. So there are many things that are there. There's an 80% where the money that you put into your coverage, the insurance company has to pay out that 80%. They can't eat the cost. I mean, they can't eat the profit. So there are many things that have to be considered, especially for folks who have addiction issues. Folks who have addiction issues have many hurdles, psychologically and physically, that they need to go through. And creating another obstacle is just going to stop them from even bothering. Thank you.
Our next speaker needs no introduction. Many of you know her as a tremendous advocate for the people of the city of Syracuse and various communities. She's won multiple awards for her advocacy and her leadership. I'm thrilled that she could join us today, so I will now give the mic to Agnes McCrae.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for the bliss for covering such a monumentous thing. You heard a lot about the numbers and everything that happened. But let me tell you what can happen to me as a person with what I like to say, extravagant differences. There's 50 million persons with extravagant differences alone that would be losing money within not even the first year. Also, I am a parent of three children, and they're all talking because they're like, Mama, how do we want to stay in the city of Syracuse if we can't be covered while we get our feet on the ground, as we want to stay here and go Syracuse? My youngest is 17 and will be graduating from Henniger in September. And he says, Mom, do you know how many programs are being cut from education already? They see it, everybody is scared. Arise, as an independent living organization, serve over 7,000 people. And they are, it's a repealing of the care that's concerned, because you people think of disability, they think of a physical disability, but there's mental health which ARISE covers, alcoholism, and so forth. And they've been in service now. This will be their 38 years. Where will all those people be and go for service? We acclimate them into community to have a better life, to have an opportunity. For me, there's not enough nursing homes that can hold all the people who will not be able to get care. And it's very scary to not know what's coming behind it at this point. We need to enjoy the number. And as we said today, we have to realize that it affects one, it affects all. Not come apart when it's just different groups. No, it's all of America. So we need to have the incoming administration be accountable for all of America, especially those of us in New York State who have always had programs that help people improve and get a better. For me, it's been, there is a program I use where I hire my own personal person. And could you understand what that would be like if that program was to go away under the tickets? So, and you know, I have to say that, well, to say so what, no, that program has been in existence now for 24 years, because it is still going strong. And when we see groups come together like that, and it doesn't, if we say it doesn't affect us, no, we will have to continue to be one America through whatever administration and whatever. So we have to think about the future of our children and tomorrow, because whether the lights are on here or they are off, we still need to have a safer and a thriving community for our people and our citizens, that is Syracuse, New York.
Thank you, Agnes. Our next speaker is Jamila Sherman.
Hey, Jamila.
Jamila Sherman, come on up, Jamila.
Hello, my name is Jamila Sherman. We need to preserve coverage for the 30 million who gained a guaranteed access for people with pre-existing conditions and provide adequate Medicaid funding to the states. I am an employee at Krause Hospital, and also a member of 1199. And I just like to say that, you know, I've been seeing lately the people that have been coming in, that they've been finding that it hasn't been a health issue, it's been a mental issue. And I'm grateful for the Affordable Act here that has brought some of these people in. But I think about it that we right now have that issue now of a lot of people with mental illnesses that are not being helped, because they don't have the health care. We can't afford for people not to be taken care of. It is gonna cause an increase in depression and stress. dependent on alcoholism and drug addiction, if we do not help those who are unable to help themselves. We live in a country that is called United States, but we are not holding to being united by helping each other. And if we do not hold to what this country has been built on, it says, in God we trust, and to be united, then we will divide. It is going to cost us more than it will cost us to take care of people as far as their health care needs than to not take care of them.
Thank you. Thank you.
Josh King. All right, Josh.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Josh King. I serve many positions in the community. First and foremost, I am a parent of my two little brothers. And to know that something like this could prevent me from being able to take care of those two little boys is crazy. It's unimaginable. I also represent the New York State Department of Health's HIV Stops With Me campaign. I'm an individual who's lived with HIV for 15 years. And to know that this Affordable Care Act repeal would mean that individuals such as myself who already face extreme adversities when it comes to healthcare and service provisions, to know that this would take away the opportunities that we have fought so hard for is, again, unimaginable. I stand in front of a mixed crowd of individuals, of community members and politicians and service providers, and this issue spans far beyond money. This is a social justice issue. This is about social responsibility, and this is about equity. And at the end of the day, individuals like her or myself or anybody in here who has children, who is a service provider, who is a politician, this all affects us all. And so I encourage everybody in this room, including the individuals who are behind me, that's a very big step for all of us to come together and stand united. As she noted, we are the United States of America, and this is our health plan. This is not something that we can allow someone to come in and make this about partisanship.
That's right.
This is about our rights as individuals, about as human beings, and as citizens of this country. So I encourage all of you guys to get involved in your local government process and have your voices heard. And I commend everybody who showed up today and with an understanding that we can come through this together. Thank you.
Well done. I'm going to pass this off to Kevin, but before I do, I just want to say to the crowd behind me, I'm so honored to be standing with all of you. We are, as was so eloquently stated, we each have our extravagant differences. This is an issue of justice, but we are the United States of America, and we are going to fight what we know our community needs. So I want to thank all of you for what is just, as I said earlier, just the first step in a great fight to make sure that we... So let me pass this off to another fighter for justice, Mr. Kevin Lockhart, who started off. Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you. Thank you, Mayor. As you've heard on this evening, we've had a lot of representatives from community groups, community organizations, and different areas. It's not going to work. It's not going to work. It's not going to work. As you see, I don't give up easy. But nevertheless, I heard that Honorable Judge McKinney is here on today as well. Thank you for being out with us. So as you've heard, how individuals can be affected, how community groups can be affected, how hospitals can be affected, also how people struggling with mental health diseases are going to be affected if this Affordable Care Act is repealed without a replacement that ensures coverage for pre-existing conditions in other areas of such. But nevertheless, this is what we're asking. We come together, we spoke about our issues, and now what are we asking from Congress? Congress needs to work together to fix what's broken with the Affordable Care Act and not simply just tear it down. Yes. I mean, it's the framework for universal health care. opposed to just destroying what we've put in place. Repealing the healthcare that millions of Americans count on, without any replacement will throw our healthcare system into chaos and harm seniors, children, and working families. Now, these are all the issues, and these are the reasons why we work. These are the reasons why we do, and in the many different areas in which we work, why we do the work we do, to take care of our families, take care of our children, and most of all, take care of our seniors. And if these things come under attack, what can they do to possibly fix it? All right, this is what we want from Congress. Any replacement must do the following. Provide coverage for 22 million who have gained it. Make sure that nobody loses coverage. Guarantee access for those with pre-existing conditions. We've got to have that as a part of the healthcare system moving forward. And also provide adequate Medicaid funding to the states to maintain affordable coverage and provide long-term care services for seniors and people with disabilities. We've got to take care of our people. We've got to take care of our people. So after we've said all this, now what are we going to do? Now there's a call to action. In a matter of days, Congress will vote to take away their health care for millions of Americans. Right now, we're asking for each and every one of us to tell Congress, show us a plan to improve health care, to improve care for every American. Do not vote to repeal the health care plan without a replacement that has the criteria that I previously had addressed as being a part of it. As you see, people with signs behind me with numbers where we can call our congressmen and let them know, don't vote to repeal the Affordable Care Act without a replacement. There's some phone numbers there, and we're going to continue to make those calls, flood the offices, to let them know no repealing of the Affordable Care Act without a replacement. Thank you, everyone, for coming out. That concludes our book for the evening.